Well, as usual, I thank the organizers for this nice invitation, and especially Nathan Paldor. Together, we broke an unwritten law at our campus that you are not allowed to talk to people from other departments. And so we keep talking to each other, and this is a great inspiration. And I apologize for some of you. It will be perhaps more ethical than other talks. I don't know, but to my defense, I can say that I noticed on the list that most people in the audience come from departments of mathematics. Okay, so it's like a sin. I'll talk about nonlinear conservation laws on surfaces. And let me remind you the scalar law on the line. We start from this. We have the Burger's classical equation, ut plus f of u of x equals 0, with initial data on the whole line. And by the way, I read someplace that the Burger's equation is the most cited equation of all equations of mathematical physics, including Schrödinger and the others. The reason is that every numerical paper on hyperbolic systems begins with a Burger's equation. Here is our example. Google's equation. Anyways. Yes, yes, we have to wait. Maybe there will be some. Anyways, I remind you what is a weak solution for a weak solution. And as usual, we know that Google's equation produces shocks inevitably. And therefore, you need weak solutions that. So distribution theory that came along for PDEs in general was very helpful for this. And it only means that formally you integrate against the test function, formally do the partial integration, and then gives you a weak solution as we all. By the way, Burgers wrote his equation actually hoping to model turbulence. It was not at all, he didn't have any shock waves in mind. Idea for uniqueness, if you have the solution, the weak solution. So you take the entropy function, again, look at it as a reminder, I'm sure you've seen things like that. You have an entropy function which is convex and entropy flux. Then the condition, the entropy condition number one is the very famous Kruskov condition, that this should be less than or equal to zero in an appropriate sense for all entropy functions. And then if you go to the physical point of view, you take zero viscosity limit of the viscous Burger's equation, that is you have viscosity. So this is the general physical way of looking at things. Whenever you have a difficulty, add a Laplacian. So you have epsilon times the Laplacian, you get nice solutions because this is a parabolic equation, even though nonlinear. But you have solutions, and then you ask about the zero viscosity limit, as is classical. So this is the equation, the zero viscosity limit, and the conclusion, the zero viscosity limit is a weak solution. This is the inspiration. You do the integration, and because of convexity, you see that actually the zero viscosity limit satisfies the entropy condition. And then came the celebrated Kruskov theorem that said that entropy condition determines a unique solution. And the proof was based on translation invariance, and the doubling of parameters became a very famous classical proof. People working in the subject. Yes, please. No, this is only a condition. The beauty of this thing is you will get the same solution satisfying all entropy inequalities at once, simultaneously. It's not, but you see it, actually you see it from the argument here. Take your favorite entropy function, it can be energy or entropy. It's different. Well, this is another. In the limit, you will get other, depending, the way you write the equation is important. This is a folklore thing going back to Rankine and Dugonio. And then you have to do the correct concert. You know what? I'll come back to it in a slide or two. Yes, exactly. Writing the equation is crucial for discontinuities, not because of entropy, but because you cannot manipulate algebraically nonlinear equations. Okay. Now we want to do the same thing on caret manifolds. So we want to replace the Bugger's equation is on a line. By the way, it had difficulties, even if you took half line with the boundary condition. Already, the method doesn't work and has to be modified. That is, when you have a boundary, of course, what you have is a zero limit, a singular limit. That is, epsilon goes to zero, you are losing a boundary condition. We have boundary layers and all kinds of things like that, but it's not so simple. Now, let's see, what are the problems if you look at the curved manifolds? First, you need to have a good definition of nonlinear vector fields is needed. So you want to write something like a ut plus div fu equals zero. Divergence is on every surface you can define divergence. But there are what we call in topology Morse constraints. You cannot have your favorite vector field. You cannot have a vector field, smooth vector field on the ball, say on the sphere, which never vanishes. You know, you cannot comb a coconut. All these things. And so, and then if you are in an unknown situation, how do you pick a vector field? Well, it's not a simple question for FU. Not take just U squared everywhere or something like that. This is one thing. Second, you lack linear structure. It's not simple to linearize equations. We know that we are talking about linearized shallow water, but in fact, to linearize a nonlinear equation, even like a Navier-Stokes or something like that, is not simple. How do you linearize? When you don't have translation invariance, you cannot control, that's a technical thing, you cannot control total variation, which is subtraction. You don't have self-similar solutions on a surface. And remind you, the Riemann problem or the shock tube problems that we are all used to in the context of Bugger's equations do not exist. There are no Riemann solutions, there are no Riemann solvers. And finally, waves produce multiple recurring interactions. Now, of course, the billiard, you take even the flat torus, as we call it, that is, you take a square with periodic boundary conditions, and you look at the simplest hyperbolic equation, ut plus ux equals zero, and then you have closed or not closed geodesics coming back, the whole billiard situation, the whole ergodic theory, everything into this most simple equation, and we are talking about more difficult. There was a question here?
Yeah.
Nothing is okay, but yes, I distinguish between the two. Yes. Okay, so let me jump immediately. These equations you have seen, this is my excuse for this talk, because if I have this slide here, I'm legitimate in this audience, right? So shallow water on a manifold, and again, answering David's question, I'll concentrate on closed manifolds because as far as I know, the Earth is always spherical or almost spherical, right? And we have, it's even legitimate to talk about ellipsoids in this audience. It has been done, officially. And so here are the equations, the shallow water equations. I write them in this form. So H is, as usual, the height. Y is a generic point on the surface S. And you have the dHdt, and then you have grad t is the geometric gradient on the surface, whatever surface, ellipsoid, say, to avoid the sphere. And so I wrote it in the way of ddt vt. Notice, actually, the concept, now coming back to your question, the right way to write it is hvt. H and hvt are the conserved quantities, because hvt is momentum. We consider that is this equation with the, these equations we derive, I'll refer to my collaborators. we derive from Lagrangian mechanics by a set of assumptions. So they are derived, you know, sort of formally on a general surface. And then we refer to H as a column of fluid, moving as a column of fluid up or down. So mass is buried in the H, the conservation of mass. And momentum is HVT, not VT. Yes, yes. I mean, we have all kinds of assumptions, and you can add other elements, and we do add heat conduction, we had topography, but I wanted to make it as simple as possible. And with the point that I'm not neglecting, I'm not leaving out the tangential component of omega, of the rotation vector. So this I insist. So this means that the hydrostatic assumption is replaced by something a little bit more complicated, because okay, if we have quasi, we have a good name for it. Yes, it's like mathematicians. Mathematicians, if I have a problem, I say let H be a smooth shell. In this answer, whatever. The word let is very good. So it's a quasi case, and so these are the equations that we are actually aiming at. Omega n is the projection of omega on the normal. It is not intrinsic. I don't want to enter into this because you want to have intrinsic geometry for your surface for reasons, mathematical, beautiful reasons that you cannot do. And the normal, of course, is not intrinsic for the embedded geometry. Anyways, and the Vt, that is the convection nonlinear term, is just the covariant derivative which we're using. Now, I wanted to emphasize the following thing. The numerical advantage, the terms, when we write it in a way which is invariant, it means that we avoid, there are no poles and no coordinates, and then we don't have some of the difficulties. We can have something which is local. We have seen it already yesterday in Professor Quasi's talk. You can, for example, take a cubed sphere. You can take coordinates that avoid completely any complications of coordinates, which if you want one coordinate system on the sphere, you'll always have to leave out the poles. So numerically, this is a big advantage because every term, you can do it locally. You can decide on, for example, what we do in the treatment, also numerical, is use Riemannian coordinates, which means we go along geodesics. Then this is very local. What? No global coordinates. We don't need to work with a system of phi lambda, for example. Yes. We is global. I thought global is common to all of us. No, you can do others. For example, you have what is called unstructured grids. But you have points scattered around, and you compute your elements. Yes, for example, theoretically, of course. And this is not intrinsic. The normal is not intrinsic, and I said it to my defense in the first line. The last line is the momentum equation, yes. Yes, I wrote it in a way which I even changed yesterday to make it fit what we have here normally. So I realized that the dt of vt, but yes, this is a total derivative that includes the covariant derivative and the t. Yes, yes, answering your question. Yes, a Lagrangian. We call it a Lagrangian derivative sometimes, you know. Okay. Then I wrote the shallow water equations on the sphere just to be on the safe side that we are all doing not only that, but answering also another question by David already, that what kind of grid? So we are actually using for the numerics, if we need presentation, as you will see, we are using the Kurihara grid. There's a story, I mean, we sort of were happy to invent this grid. The advantage of this grid is that up to the pole, all the cells are basically of the same area, roughly. So you take less points as you, and less cells as you approach the pole here. So, and then we discovered, actually in a very nice review paper by Williamson, that there was a Japanese using the same grid called Kurihara, and there's a beautiful paper, so we are happy. Yes. You can say so. You can say that the scale is cosine there or one over cosine. Yes. Approximately. I mean, you cannot get it, but they are all the same scale. I mean, if you use just latitude and longitude, you'll never get it, right? Okay, so you can say morally the same, yes. But by the way, you also want, for numerical reasons, more than theoretical reasons, to keep the sides of roughly equal side. You don't want to have too narrow, you're using the finite volume accuracy, say, of the numerical, yes. But this is another constraint. Oops. So these are the, this is the equation for H. As we all know, with lambda and phi, and of course you'll have to avoid the poles. And this is interesting. This is when we write it in terms of coordinates, and this is why I'm bringing it here, I add the red elements, you see? Without the red elements, these are the equations that appeared here in the last 2 days or even before, a lot of times. With the red elements, this means that we are taking the tangential component of omega into consideration. And then you see this delta. It is zero if omega t is zero if we just take the normal, do a beta plane analog or whatever. One if we keep the omega t. So think of it as delta equal to one in the red terms, and then you have additional red terms. And you know what? Interestingly enough, the red terms, they look like complication of the equations. They simplify the equations in some sense. That is, they allow a better analysis of phrase. I'm not entering into this, but there is a certain simplification that, for example, you'll see, okay, so notation, or here. So leave the notation is the usual thing, as you see. And the gravity waves, so you take now delta equal to one, as I said. So you have omega delta phi. Delta equal to one is omega cosine phi, a term that we all know exists. And then the characteristic, and you know, we are talking about two spatial coordinates. Locally, we are like on a Euclidean plane with two coordinates, right? So you don't have characteristics, you have characteristic surfaces. If you concentrate on one point, this is what is called the light cone for every point, like the emerging bicharacteristics, or the Munch cone, if you want this kind of terminology. And so you have different directions where the optical rays are going, approximate, the linearized version. And so here, and these are the gravity waves, these are the acoustic waves. So I took, for example, in the lambda direction, that is like an intersection of the Munch cone with the lambda direction, and you see that the speed of sound is different. It's not what you expect. Normally, you expect the square root HG, right? And I took this geoid, geoid approximation, but and you see that now it is different. And you see it, it's a different speed of characteristics. It could be relevant or not, I don't know, but this is formally obtained from the mm. 20 minutes, right? Yes, I'll negotiate every minute. Yeah. Okay, now here is a story. What I mean, in this audience is well known. So here is a jet stream, and here is the jet stream 1 week later. I was at the conference in Vancouver, September 2006. And then my hobby at the airport at that time, I don't know, it does not exist now, was the paper that called the newspaper USA Today. And the most interesting page was the last page. The last page was all about climate. And I know my wife was, why are you interested in the temperature in Hong Kong? We are now in Seattle. But I said, no, it's a lot of fun to see all these places, London always freezing and so on, and raining and whatever. Yeah. Right. No, it changed since then, you see it. Well, it's our business. But then you see a tale of two troughs. What was the jet stream goes like this, the jet stream goes like that, and this sort of determines according to them where is hot, where is rainy. Right, here is the previous one. It was rainy around Vancouver, and then it changed. And then I gave a talk, I met Polvani in New York at Columbia. They said, you know, our goal is to produce this on the computer. To start with the jet stream, and this was more than 10 years ago. To start with the jet stream and to calculate where this jet stream will be 1 week later. We are still not there, I think. But this is our noble aim. Okay, so this is the jet stream. Purpose of talk, finally. It's got to be the purpose of this talk. Develop a theory for nonlinear conservation loss on manifolds using parabolic techniques or Young measures that are called compensated compactness. And this can be done only for the scalar conservation law. And so this brings us back to the classical mathematical situation. We are always ages behind you guys. You know, we clean up still the scalar case. But I was justified because the quasi-geostrophic case that we have with a Q, it is also a single scalar law. And also an evolution equation, scalar evolution equation, nonlinear. In some sense, I am in the right class. Uh-huh. Okay, we will not dwell too much about the technicalities, the bounded variation elements. This is all the standard differential geometry stuff that you know from first course. The tangent bundle, and we have a metric in this business, and the derivatives, and the cotangent. And then we use the summation convention, Einstein's, and all this stuff is well known on the surface, nothing very standard. And the differential of a function is a cotangent is a section in the cotangent bundle. And then, of course, there is the gradient, and the covariant derivative, which is important, is given with the Christoffel symbols. And so all this is a reminder. This divergence of the vector field, again, we all remember what it is. And the divergence is, of course, the dual operator to the gradient. So here I come to give credit. So this work, all this work was a series of papers with LeFloch in Paris and Falcovitz in my campus. Joseph Falcovitz. And then there is a beautiful series of papers, much more general, by David Lengeler and Thomas Müller, both in Germany, one I think in Leipzig and the other in Freiburg. So these are the results. Later on, I'm not going to specify which result is what, but just this is a production of all these works since then, including some numerical work. And They, Langeler and Miller, went much further in terms of towards the Einstein situation, namely a metric that is also a function of time, manifolds that evolve, all this kind of stuff, so much more advanced in some sense, building on previous work. But I'm not going to specify exactly. Okay, we begin with definitions. What is a flux? Remember, we said that vector field on a surface is very, nonlinear vector field is very difficult to produce because we have the Morse constraints, among others. So a flux on the manifold Mn is a vector field F, Fxu. So we reverse the thing. U becomes now a parameter, a formal parameter, nothing to do with the equation. And for every formal parameter U, so we have an infinite family because it's every real parameter, we have your favorite vector field. You take it, Fx. So x is the variable on the surface. The conservation law associated with the flux is the one number 9, dtu plus divergence g of fxu equals 0, where the unknown, you plug in, you have what is a solution, utx, is something that you plug instead of the u bar, and then you have a vector field. This will be a legitimate vector field, f of utx, because it's the combination of two, superposition of two functions that are smooth. We are talking about smooth stuff. So this is legitimate, and then divergence in 9, the divergence is a divergence with respect to x as an external variable and the hidden variable inside u already. So for every point x, you'll put the u tx there. The flux is called geometry compatible if it satisfies the divergence free condition. That is, if you take free as your parameter, then the divergence is 0. In other words, it means that if you start with something, a function which is 0, initial data, it will stay 0. It will not be produced by divergence non-zero. So that's all the requirement. But of course, Langeler and Thomas and Müller went behind that. Yes. Yes. As putting, yeah. Here, the answer is the next slide. So I'll try to explain. You have infinitely many vector fields parameterized by u. Take, for example, ut plus fux equals 0. This is exactly your question. What do I do different? So for this equation, actually, I assume that for every u bar, I have actually a constant field. So it is the most, the Bugers equation from this point of view becomes a trivial thing. For every u bar, it is just a constant vector field along R because we have only one space dimension. And of course, I'm cheating. This is not, this manifold is open and infinite, right? But okay, but for the illustration. But so fxu for every u bar is just a constant that, you know, is the chalk? Ah, here. So actually, this means that you look at R, and at every point x, it is the same vector. And the vector is some constant depending on u bar. What do you do with solving the equation? For every x, you have at a given time t, you have a value utx, and you plug it in here. So it is a constant depending on u bar, but the u bar at the point x becomes utx. It gets a different value, say, forget about t, but in x first. So this gives you, finally, the field fx of utx, which you need. That's what I mean. No, it means that you begin your problem with infinitely many vector fields. We have to answer the question to go around all those Morse constraints. We have to make a definition of a Bugers equation. And you know, sometimes like in Alice in Wonderland, you want to see it, try for yourself, you know, this Dodo game. So try to write a Bugers equation on the surface. forget about all our inventions. And then you'll see that these difficulties exist in mathematical physics. Remember in the Maxwell equations, for example, you cannot manage if you want on a surface, you have to make the magnetic field, for example, a two-form, the electric field a one-form. So you resort also to some kind of a geometric differential trick. Not like just vector fields. You cannot do that. So you can ask the question even there. Yes, ma'am. Again? Yes, I mean, yeah, when I start negotiating for time, you'll see the concrete example. Yes. Including the timeout, right? Yeah. Okay, so the best way is, I think the best exercise is to think, what would you do on the sphere if you wanted to have a Bugger's equation, a scalar equation that expresses nonlinearity, hyperbolicity, et cetera, et cetera. What can you do? How can you write it? And then you'll probably come up with this solution, or maybe better. In the beginning, we had worse. We had all kinds of N-forms, you know, to do with jets, things like that, those who know. Anyway, so this is the entropy function, and you have to define everything from the beginning. You do the Bugger's equation, and as I apologize to you in the beginning, the theory goes only for scalar equations. Of course, we would love to do it for the full system of nonlinear shallow waters, but this is not done even for the Euler compressible equations on the plane. There is no result, basically. Okay, let me keep all this, the total variation. Okay, let me come to this regularized initial value. So now we follow the path suggested by physics and by mathematicians, etc. So we regularize the equation with the U epsilon, right? So we add a viscosity term. The Laplacian is, of course, the Laplacian on the surface, the geometric Laplacian. And we need also to cook initial data. This is just to point out that, for example, here, all this cooking, we need to have, we are given a U0. Forget what is the exact space. We want to smooth the U0. Now I remind you, this is also in Einstein's equations, when you have the elliptic constraints to prepare initial data. We all realize that. So there is a famous, so it's elliptic system to prepare initial data. So now it is not so easy, and I'm not getting into details. If you are on a surface and you get a U0 and you want to smooth it out, it's not so easy to have a U0 epsilon that will do all kinds of conditions that you want. For example, this one, or this one on H2. H2 is the Sobolev space. So even there, you begin with something, and then you have, and you fail to find a solution which will converge. I mean, if you don't do that, and you start with just a U0 epsilon, you have to guarantee that as epsilon goes to zero, your solution will go to something. But then you rely on the approximation of the initial data. Otherwise, it doesn't work, not for us. So regularized, I'm not going to discuss this. We can return to it. Of course, questions will be welcomed. Then that U epsilon does exist. This is, of course, a nonlinear parabolic equation. It's simpler than Ricci flows or things like that, but there is a whole sense of geometric flows on manifolds, of course, which lead to beautiful PDEs, as we all know. This is simpler than that. But still, it needs some work to do parabolic equations, nonlinear parabolic equations on a manifold. And to get contraction properties and all this, let's not dwell on this too much. And the convergence, this is your question, as you have this vanishing diffusion, that is, as epsilon goes down to zero, you will get a solution ut, let me not, and with all kinds of estimates that will depend, behind this there is some geometry. the Ricci curvature enters the game, and so on. This measures the difference between the doubly differentiated function in the two indices, ij and ji, for example. It is normally, it is on the plane, it is zero, but otherwise it is Ricci. Anyways, so the limit ut is obtained by a subsequence, and we do not claim uniqueness at this point. This is just a subsequence as a classical compactness fact. Singularity measure, for example, so the total variation. So suppose you take u0, you see a non-smooth u0, which is 1 in a domain omega, and 0 outside. So this is a characteristic function of a domain omega within the surface. So the total variation in this case is exactly the Lebesgue measure of the surface. And when I gave a talk at Courant, this is Peter Lux mentioned that, and he said, yes, if you have an estimate, this means that as your patch is convected nonlinearly, the patch remains singular in the sense that the perimeter, the measure of the surface, does not become something like fractal, something like whatever that means. It is a worry, but so it has some regularity to it. But this shows that what we need to do is approximate this u0, answering your question, by some u0 epsilon that at the same time, here you have like a tableau like this, and you need to approximate and approximate it correctly. Okay, let me skip all these techniques for now. And of course, what is the measure valued entropy solution? Finally, you get, let us just read this theorem quickly and then pass to examples. Let F be a geometry compatible flux on a Riemannian manifold, and let U0 be just L infinity function. Then there exists a unique entropy measure-valued solution, which I skipped. What is a measure-valued? This, by the way, should be credited at first to Diperna and all these group school followers, and then the Tartar in Paris, Murat. So for almost every Tx, the measure solution is a Dirac mass, which means that it gives a unique value at delta at a number Utx, and this number is the solution in some miraculous way and in some sense of convergence. Let's skip that. The proof of theorem 9, and so I remind you that instead of the Kruskov of the doubling of parameters and the x, you don't have x minus y on the manifold. There is no difference between two points. So you need to replace it. What you replace it is by tensor products of such measures and to replace the things that you don't know. But let me keep all this and the total variations with their, this some Lie algebra. But let me go to the sphere. Yes. So this case is important in the, but of course the PDF stays here. So the people who are very interested in the previous slides, they exist, right? They'll exist in the archive here. So this case is important in the geophysical applications. I found the right audience to make this statement. And characterize the general geometry compatible flux, utilize the embedded representations, and find some solutions. And now, so this is the Kurihara grid that we are using for computations, actually. Remind you of all the things that appeared so frequently, even talk that just before, and so conservation, so we take the conservation law on the sphere, we go back to the Burger's equation on the sphere, which is, in terms of the components, is the equation number 35. So you have an equation on the sphere. Let me show you, in local coordinates, flux depends explicitly, that is, you cannot make a flux, Burger's equation is f of u, u squared, for example. But here in two coordinates, the flux must depend explicitly on lambda phi. Now, this means lambda phi in the usual jargon. But this means that you cannot have self-similarity, all kinds of things like that. And you need to satisfy the null divergence condition. You take a tubular neighborhood, you take your sphere, and you put, now we are beginning with a very practical part. So this is the, you take a spherical shell to embed the sphere in a spherical shell like that. We call it a tubular, the geometers are calling it a tubular. It is like a tube everywhere. And then this is a statement. Every point we asked about what are the appropriate vector fields that will satisfy geometry conditions. So you have this condition, number 37. Every smooth flux on the sphere, it is a semi-trivial statement, but I'm not going, is produced by taking the normal, the unit normal, is by the way true also for ellipsoids. Okay. Taking the unit normal here and cross product with phi, with the general vector field parametrized by u, and so I wrote phi u nux, meaning that you take a vector field which is constant in the normal direction, but it shouldn't be, it doesn't have to be. And then, so you have a different equation, number 38 in this business, when you take phi. So this is the way to reduce for practical reasons. And if the map phi coincides with the gradient of some potential, then you are guaranteed a divergence-free condition, which is, again, very non-simple in some sense. Okay. Now, look at steady-state solutions, for example. Now we begin with examples I was asked before. So we are all now about examples. So you take a flux vector, fux, which is given by the normal vector product with f1u, any function of your desire, you pick your function, times i1. I1 is the unit vector in the x1 direction, in space, in R3. The tubular neighborhood. An arbitrary choice of the function f1, then in any function u0 of x1, depending only on the first coordinate x1, is a stationary solution to the conservation law associated with the flux. In particular, take any function, any initial function, which is a function of cosine phi, cosine lambda. Look at an example, steady state. So I take f1u, these are the details, I take f1u to be exactly the Burgers. They have, and the initial data is cosine lambda cosine phi, which means that it is not zonal. It is more complicated than a zonal, and I'm using the coordinates, the usual coordinates. So look at that. So this is the stationary solution, cosine lambda cosine phi, after many, many, many steps in time. So a steady state solution, you take it and you do it for a long time, and it is the same as the initial data. That is, it doesn't change. If I showed you the initial data, I could say this is the initial data, or this is the initial, or this is the result after 50 days. It looks the same. For this cosine lambda, cosine phi, of course, this can be tried on any code. If you have a code, even if more general, you can somehow simplify to a scalar equation and see what happens with conditions like that. This is a color scale. Blue is the light blue is zero. And red is the. Okay, so this is confined solutions. This means, again, without going into the details, but solutions you can confine, this is not Burgers. You can confine solution to any subdomain D. You can make sure that you have like a trap, mouse trap like that, that you have a solution that rigorously avoids another part, the outside of D, and stays within D, even. And then you get all kinds of possibilities for solutions. So let us now not go into the details. And so you take the steady state, for example, you take the steady state and you cut off part of it by zero. And you want to make it confined. So then it will be confined to the part which is not zero. For example, all the part behind is zero, close to zero. And this steady state, this is even more complicated because you have a strip which is with time evolution, a part which is not touched in this steady state, and the part which is zero. on the sphere immediately. I mean, the picture is not so explicit about that. But then you can test the analytic solution. It's semi-analytic because the part which evolves you cannot do analytically. It's too complicated. For a special flux. Any function of cosine, lambda, cosine, phi will be a steady state solution. Well, this means that you are asking me to look at shocks or something. And I avoid doing it. I'll answer your question in a second. It's a good question. Sort of approaching. Okay, so this is test case periodic solution. So you take the same Curry-Hara grid, and you see this is initial data. And now here the test is not trivial numerically. I mean, you design conditions that it will stay within a strip, and the result is that it stays within a strip, only that you see that the red becomes less red. That is, it is the amplitude diminishes. This is after many, many, many cycles. But it stays in the grid and does not spill over to the other grids nearby, for example, which for us was a good test. Dembrake, I'll skip those just to show that we had a few examples that everybody can do. But then, of course, everybody realizes the Williamson test, number one, a moving patch. So you start with a moving patch. Answering your question, this can be discontinuous. I mean, we tried it with discontinuous. You have like a tableau or something. But the Williamson is not, is bell-shaped, as we all know. So, you design, this is a linearized problem because you design the vector field so that this patch moves, passes near the pole and goes back. Now, see what happens if we do it with what is called Godunov diffusion, that is a diffusive numerical scheme. After one cycle that is coming back after one period, it is quite smeared, as you see. This is not what we consider as a good numerical result, because we don't want it. And then, of course, we go to high order, what is called generalized Riemann problems, and so on. And this is even after quite a few periods, and passing not far from the pole, which means that numerically it's challenging because the grid is so sorted, but we get a very reasonable solution there. Okay, so I guess I'll just skip the finite volume method is there, and I made my time. So, thank you very much.